And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, on the Fleet Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. It's been 6 months I've been trying to get this guy. I saw this guy on YouTube, and I said, wow, I had no idea that there was an advocate for the Fifth Amendment. The book is called You Have the Right to Remain Innocent. It's an urgent, compact manifesto that will teach you how to protect your rights, your freedom, and your future when talking to the police. Professor, law professor James Duane, became a viral sensation in 2008 when he was lecturing, outlining the reasons why you should never talk to the police. And I don't know how many millions of views later, he decided to turn this into a book. And I have finally got a chance to have him on the show. Welcome, my friend, Professor James Duane. How are you?
Great. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be with you, Philippe.
All right, so let's get down to the nitty gritty here. When I talk to you and I read this book, I'm still in the middle of it right now. I was reading it on my Kindle. Case after case after case of innocent people convicting themselves by simply speaking and talking to the police. This seems to be a contraindicated kind of thing. We think that talking to the police is something that's going to help us, that is going to help them solve their case or what have you. And in actuality, that is not the case. Let's go through this step by step if we could.
Sure.
So why shouldn't we talk to the police?
Well, the book gives about a dozen different reasons, but the most important reason, the one that you mentioned a moment ago, and the most surprising reason for most folks who read the book, is the fact that even innocent people can very easily give the police information that could be used to incriminate them or get them convicted for a crime they didn't commit. You know, we've all heard about the Innocence Project, a fabulous national organization that has secured the release of over 300 innocent men and women who were falsely convicted and imprisoned for crimes they didn't commit. And when they went back and took a look at the trial transcripts to see how are we doing this? How are we convicting so many innocent people of crimes that we know they didn't do? They found that about 25% of them, that's a quarter of them, were convicted in part or entirely on the basis of information that they had given to the police. Wow. So it's not some sort of an urban legend or a myth. It's an absolute fact that innocent people are actually convicted in part on the basis of information they gave to the police.
So unbelievable.
Go ahead. That's why, as it says in the book, the name of the book, as you said, I've got a copy here. It's called You Have the Right to Remain Innocent. And as you can see, the geniuses in marketing have designed it so that it's the perfect size for a stocking stuffer. So if your listeners are still looking for some Christmas gift shops, gift ideas, this is a great gift for the kids. It's only a couple of bucks, and it may keep your little ones out of prison.
You might be joking, but it's not really a joke. You're really serious, and I know you, and I know your heart. And I know that you are really an advocate of the Fifth Amendment, because right. What happens is that unfortunately, the people who are poor and the people mostly who are black and brown, those are usually the ones who are in this situation. It happens to everyone, but for the majority, it happens to people of color and people who do not have financial means. And so they assume that speaking to the police will help them. This is a book that literally will save your child's life and perhaps your life as well. So this is a very serious topic. Why did you decide, out of all of your entire law career, all of what you have accomplished, why did you decide to make the Fifth Amendment your advocacy?
Well, because I had learned over the years as a professor and as a criminal defense lawyer that far too many people don't understand the way the criminal justice system works. And this is common knowledge. I mean, every police officer knows it. Every defense attorney knows it. Every judge knows it. The prosecutors do too. The average man on the street, it's not his fault. Even if he's relatively sophisticated and intelligent and relatively well educated, if he's not experienced with the nuances and the pitfalls of the criminal justice system, will almost invariably make the mistake of thinking, well, when the police want to talk to me, I know, or I think I've got nothing to hide because I think I've done nothing wrong. I know in my heart that I'm innocent. So surely it can only help for me to talk to these people. I can only clear things up. The police know, by the way, that you harbor that misconception, and they will take advantage of it every time. Because if you hesitate and you act like you're not sure whether you want to talk to them, they'll act puzzled. They'll act confused. And they'll say, I don't get it, Philippe. Why don't you want to talk to me? You say you're innocent, right? You say you've done nothing wrong. Well, if you've done nothing wrong, then why not talk to us? Maybe you can clear things up for us. We're trying to help you, but you got to help us. And it's nonsense, and it's all false from top to bottom. And we know that it's false, by the way, as I explain in the book, because we also know this is not what police are telling their own children. The subtitle, the title of the book is You Have the Right to Remain Innocent. the subtitle of the book is What Police Officers Tell Their Own Children About the Fifth Amendment. Because after when I made that video you talked about earlier, about 8 years ago, I recorded a video that went viral on YouTube. About 10 million people have seen it. And I started to get invitations to speak about the subject all around the country. I've spoken to thousands of college and law school students around the country. And to explain to them, you know, the subject of the book, what I didn't expect to learn from this experience, there was something I actually learned from this experience, is I went around the country speaking to young students. I quickly discovered that everywhere I went, there would be in every large group at least one or two who would raise their hand or come up to me afterwards and say, hey, you know, my mom's a cop, my father's with the DEA, my mother's a prosecutor, you get the picture. And they told me the same thing when I was 10 years old. And it's gotten to the point now where when I give a speech on this subject, I'll usually begin by saying, is there anybody here who's got a mom or a dad who's a prosecutor or a police officer? And if it's a large group, there will usually be one or two hands. And I'll say, I don't even know who these people are. And I'll say to them, tell everybody else what your mom told you about the Fifth Amendment. And so far, 100%, none of them, no exceptions, 100% of them have said, well, they told me don't talk to the police. I mean, that's really, to me, that's an obscene double standard, because the reality is all around the country, even right now, while you and I are talking here, all over this country, there are police officers behind closed doors lying to young men and women, to other people's children, and saying, and lying to them by telling them, well, I want to help you, and I want to give the judge your side of the story, but you got to talk to me, and trying to convey to these young men and women it's in their own best interest to waive their right to remain silent. And then when these same police officers go home at night and talk to their own kids, they say exactly the opposite. And they say to the kids, listen, Johnny, Judy, get over here. Promise me, for as long as you live, promise me you will never let some other police officer do to you what I do to other people's kids all day long. Don't ever let them talk you into giving up your right to remain silent. And that was my motivation. That's what persuaded me that I needed to get the word out. Because it's a scandal. It ought to be a national scandal that we are convicting so many innocent people. It's a fact. We see it in the paper. Every day you pick up the paper and you read about, here's another poor guy, and usually it's a racial minority, as you said, who's being let out of prison with our sincere apologies because after 20, 30 years in prison, DNA now proves apparently we got the wrong guy. And we sometimes give them a little bit of money for their trouble. But we aren't nearly serious enough as a nation about doing what it takes to try to prevent this at the front end. We shouldn't be putting these people behind bars to begin with. We're convicting too many innocent people. And one of the things that we're doing, well, a big part of the problem, is that too many innocent people who don't understand what they're up against and the risks that they face are foolishly being pressured and tricked into giving up the right to remain silent. I'm trying to make sure my mission, like yours, with your help today, is to try to get the word out so that every American of every age and of every socioeconomic background will understand what all the police officers are telling their own kids.
Well, here's the oxymoron, and that is, you know, I remember having an attorney on who was an advocate of the Fourth Amendment, you know, like when the police approach you, and want to talk to you, say, hey, am I free to go? You know, invoking the Fourth,
I agree with that.
Yeah, do you agree with that? And so, you know, if not, and you're detained, then invoke the Fifth. And so, is that logical? Because it's like, what should we give to the police when they pull us over, or is there a difference between when they pull us over versus if they see us in the street or something and say, come over here, I want to talk to you? What are those nuances? Because it's basically you're saying, under no circumstance, do not talk to the police. So is there a point where that's legal, illegal, in our best interest, not in our best interest?
Sure, right. Well, you know, I'm not the first one to say this, and neither was your other guest. You know, Robert Jackson was a famous justice of the U.S. Supreme Court. And before he was on the U.S. Supreme Court, by the way, he was the Attorney General of the United States. And he was the Solicitor General of the United States. And he was also the Chief Prosecutor of the war crimes trials in Nuremberg. And he wrote an opinion when he was on the Supreme Court in which he said that no lawyer worth his salt would fail to tell the client not to talk to the police under any circumstances. And this is from the former Attorney General of the United States. So for your listeners, for their benefit, I want them to understand that this is not just the typical liberal claptrap they would expect from a criminal defense attorney like me. Even the former Attorney General said this, and by the way, he was right. But as far as he was the one who said under no circumstances should you talk to the police, but even he, I'm sure, understood that there are nuances here. Like you said, if you're pulled over for a routine traffic stop, police officer pulls you over while you're driving the vehicle, then you've got to talk to them a little bit. You can't just sit there silently saying nothing at all. That'll only make the situation worse. You want to talk to them, but as little as possible. You'll be cooperative. You'll be polite. You'll be respectful. Don't be disrespectful, not even if you think they deserve it. That's not going to make your situation any better. You know, yes, sir, and no, sir, will do you a lot of good. You can talk your way out of getting a traffic ticket because the police officers have a great deal of discretion, as we all know, as to whether to give you a ticket and what to write the ticket up for, or whether to let you off with a warning maybe this time. Many of us have been in a situation. I've been in a situation. I've been pulled over by police, and I've talked to them in that particular setting, and I'll answer a couple of simple questions in a way that tries to convey to them that I'm not intoxicated, I'm respectful, I'm not disrespectful, and I've been in situations, as many others have, where the police officer decides, well, I'm not going to give you a ticket this time, and they let you on your way. So it's all right to talk to them a little bit under those circumstances. But even then, be careful about what you do and what you do not say. Don't let the police get you tricked into answering questions about where you've been and what you've been doing. Where were you earlier tonight? Where were you at 8 o'clock? You mind if I ask you where you were at 8 o'clock and who you were with? Don't answer that question under any circumstances. It's a risk that simply is not worth taking. They can't make you answer that question, and the Fifth Amendment gives you the right to refuse to answer that question. See, the problem is, if the police ask you, where were you at 8 o'clock tonight? And you tell them, oh, I was with this other guy. I was with a couple of friends of mine. What you may not understand, chances are, if you haven't done anything wrong, the chances are very good that you'll never live to regret giving them that information. But you never know, and it's a risk that isn't worth taking. If you tell them you were with a couple of your friends down near the high school at 8 o'clock, and it turns out that what you say was perfectly true, tragically, you're running the horrible risk that you might be placing yourself at the scene of a crime. Maybe somebody else dropped by the high school and started a fire there only 10 or 15 minutes later. It's improbable, it's unlikely, but it happens. I mean, the book gives multiple examples, like you said.
Yes, it's amazing. Of one guy. Oh my gosh. Ladies and gentlemen, when you read this, you have to get this book. This is a must read. It's a link right there in the right below the description in the YouTube channel. It doesn't cost that much on Kindle. It doesn't cost that much on to purchase it. It's a book that you need to have this book next to the Bible. That's all I'm saying. and particularly for my people of color, this is a book that you must have. If you do not have it and don't understand it, you are probably at some point going to lose someone you love. And it might be you. And I had no idea how easy it is for someone to lose their life. And when I say lose their life, I'm talking about losing their freedom. There was something in there where you wrote where basically based upon these crazy titles, title from title 18 to 17, what have you, that, you know, people are committing, you could be sitting at your home innocently just watching television. You might commit 3 felons in a day and not even know what you've done as a result of that's how crazy these laws are.
Yes.
So please talk to us about this thing that you...
Can I add a suggestion too?
Yeah, please.
You suggested a moment ago that if everybody get a copy of the book and keep it on their nightstand right next to the Bible. It's excellent advice. And let me recommend in addition that they keep the Bible open to chapter 13 of the book of Proverbs, verse 3, where King Solomon wrote, "He who guards his lips preserves his life, but he who opens wide his mouth shall have destruction."
Very good. Well said. You know, this is a serious thing. Confirmation bias was the first time I've known of this bias, and I've known of this bias used in other contexts, but I didn't know that you would use it in the context as it relates to the Fifth Amendment. Explain to us about confirmation bias as it relates to law enforcement in the Fifth.
Sure. I'm glad to. Yes. As I explain in the book, this book is not meant in any way as a diatribe against the police. I've got no animosity toward these people, most of whom are very brave and valiant and noble men and women. But the problem I've got with the police is that they're only human. And that's the problem. Because human beings, we're imperfect. And our memories aren't perfect. And we are subject to psychological pressures and phenomena that we're not entirely always aware of. And one of them is the problem of confirmation bias, which is a term that has been coined by psychologists to describe the well-documented tendency of every human being, whether they're a police officer or anybody else, to remember things in ways that coincide with their initial position. If you make a public position or stake out a public position of one sort or another on a controversial topic, and you announce publicly, this is where I stand and this is what I feel, or you make an accusation on a particular subject, as time goes by, you will invariably find that your memories, as they come back to you about that event, will almost invariably tend to ratify or to coincide with or to or to corroborate the thing that you have said publicly. Here's how it applies to a police officer. When a police officer makes an arrest of an individual, they don't make this accusation lightly. They know that this is a very serious step. It's a momentous step. If it's a very serious charge like murder or rape, it's a very serious step. It may result in this individual being taken off the streets and thrown in jail at least for a couple of nights, perhaps for several months while he's waiting for trial. And as time goes by, it becomes more and more difficult for the police officer to face up to the reality that, oh, we may have made a horrible mistake here. We might have the wrong guy. I mean, we've seen this played out again and again. You look at the famous case in Duke University, the Duke lacrosse team that was rounded up, those young men and accused of sexual assault. The government thought at first that his case was extraordinarily solid, and the prosecutor said so at a press conference. But more and more inconsistencies and difficulties started to emerge, and over time, it gradually became clear to almost every objective observer that there was really no solid case there at all. But the prosecutor couldn't back down. It was too late. He couldn't have bring himself to admit that maybe he had made a terrible mistake. Here in Norfolk, there were four Navy sailors who were pressured, heavily pressured, into giving confessions to a rape that we now know that they did not commit. And when the DNA evidence came back and revealed that none of them had actually been involved, and that there was one other man who didn't even know them who was involved, even then the prosecutor and the police couldn't bring themselves to say, okay, oh my gosh, we made a horrible mistake. And you can't blame them, of course, because the problem is if you admit that you made a big mistake, not only does it look extraordinarily embarrassing, it makes it difficult to sleep at night, and it also opens them up to the possibility of being sued civilly for damages for false arrest. They don't want to live up to that possibility. In the book, I give examples of how this works. I talked about the tragic example of a friend of mine, Earl Ruffin, who lives right here in Norfolk, Virginia. Earl was convicted and sentenced to life in prison for a rape that we now know that he didn't commit. And one of the things that was used to help convict him was the details of a truthful statement that he gave to the police. He was a brother who was accused or suspected of having possibly raped a white woman in her home in the middle of the night. And when the police contacted him and asked if he would mind answering a couple of questions. He made the foolish mistake, the tragic mistake. I don't blame him. He's a friend of mine. I'm not condemning him. Most people in that particular situation make the terrible mistake of saying that, sure, I'll talk to you. I know I'm innocent. I can only help to clear things up. They said, where were you that night? And he told them the truth. He said, oh, I know where I was that night. I was playing cards with my brother and his girlfriend and my girlfriend too. I had not one but three alibi witnesses, he told the police, probably with a great deal of satisfaction. He was probably very happy with the fact that he had all these witnesses who could back up his story. And I would suspect, by the way, that most of your listeners who are with us listening right now are probably thinking to themselves, well, that sounds like a good thing to tell the police. I mean, if you've got alibi witnesses who can corroborate your story that you weren't with this woman, surely that can only help, right? Well, that's a natural mistake to make, but it's a terrible mistake to make, and he paid for it with his life, because what happened was, when the police officer went out and met with these individuals and checked with these various individuals, they did corroborate his story, which is not a surprise, because don't forget, like I said, DNA evidence later proved 20 years later that he was innocent, and that he was telling the truth all along. But just before the case went to trial, just a few days before the trial was about to begin, the police officer suddenly announced to the prosecutor and to the defense attorney, you know, I just remember something about that confession that I forgot to write in my notes. During the interview, several months earlier, the police officer had typed in his notes that Earl Ruffin told me that he was with his girlfriend there that night. Months go by, and on the eve of trial, the police officer suddenly announces at the last minute, you know, I just remember three more words that I forgot to put in my report. He told me that he was with her at her house. But when I went to check with the witnesses, they all said that they were at Earl's house. Well, now it sounds like all of these witnesses are contradicting what Earl had said to the police, which in fact they never did, because that's not what he had said. But this police officer, God bless him, it probably wasn't even his fault. I don't know this cop. I doubt that he was trying to intentionally frame an innocent man. I certainly hope that didn't happen in this case. But he was the victim of confirmation bias. He knew that they were on the verge of a trial where the case was starting to fall apart. He knew that it was looking like a weak case, and with good reason, I might add, because the man was innocent. But suddenly his mind starts to play tricks on him. He starts to remember three simple little words that weren't there in the report because they were never said, quite frankly. But those three words suddenly take what would have been a key piece of evidence for the defense and now suddenly turns it into a key piece of evidence for the prosecutor. Because now it looks like, you see, what he told the police totally contradicts what they're saying now about where the card game was played. You see, this is the game that you're playing every time you put your cards on the table. The police don't have to put their cards on the table, but they'll try to get you to do every way they can. There's only one way to avoid this possibility. There's only one way to eliminate this possibility. You've got to do what the police are telling their own kids. Don't talk to the police. If you've got a great story, if you've got great alibi witnesses, super. Tell your lawyer all about it, and you present them at trial. But then there'll be no possibility that these people can be attacked or impeached with mistaken allegations that maybe they've changed their story over time.
So what happens in a situation where you don't talk to the police, you do invoke the Fifth Amendment, and then you're labeled that you're not cooperating with the police, and they get very upset. I mean, obviously, you were saying that you know it's getting very very difficult to invoke the Fifth Amendment now because of the problem is an educated consumer, I would say, or educated civilians, and so. These guys don't want to get sued. They want to get promoted.
Yes.
They want to get it right. They want to protect the blue badge, the shield. So they literally will do almost anything to be right and to try to get you to give up your right, your constitutional right to plead the Fifth.
Yes, they will. Yes, they will. But you shouldn't be worried about that. Your reaction, that's an excellent question. And it's a very natural reaction. Countless people in that same situation make the terrible mistake of thinking, geez, I better talk to them. I better answer their questions. If I take the Fifth and say that I don't want to talk to them, it'll look incriminating. It'll look suspicious. They'll think I've got something to hide. Which, by the way, I'm happy to assure is absolutely not true. That is not what you will look. That is not how you will look. And that is not what they will think. You see, because remember, like I said earlier, the average man on the street who doesn't really know exactly how the system works naturally subscribes to the widespread myth of thinking there's two groups of people out there. There's the guilty and there's the innocent. The innocent, they talk to the police, just like we see every night at Law and Order. And then you got the guilty people, and they're the ones who take the Fifth. That's just not true. The reality is there's two huge groups of people out there, all right, but that's not their names. There's the sophisticated and the well-informed and the educated. Those are the ones who know how the criminal justice system works because they've been involved in it, because their lawyers or prosecutors or police officers, or because their fathers or mothers are police officers or prosecutors. And these are the ones who take the Fifth every time. It's not because some of them are guilty and some of them are innocent. It doesn't make a difference. They all take the Fifth because they know how the system works. Then there's this other group out there who don't assert the rights under the Fifth Amendment. This tragically large group that waives the Fifth Amendment just about every chance they get, and they agree to talk to the police. That group includes a lot of guilty people and a lot of innocent people. The only thing they have in common is that they're uninformed and they don't know how the system works. And the police know this reality. So if you tell the police respectfully but politely, I'm sorry, I won't answer any questions, not unless you get me a lawyer. Get me my lawyer here. I won't answer any questions. The police officer, more often than not, will act suspicious. He'll act like he thinks that what you're doing is evidence of criminality, but it's just
enough. They're going to play an entire role here. They're going to actually, you know, try to get an Oscar nomination for this.
Yes, yes. They're like confused, and they'll say, Philippe, I don't get it. You keep telling me you're innocent, but why would an innocent man not want to talk to me? But you know, but in his heart, what the cop is thinking to himself is not that you're guilty, but he's thinking is, okay, I guess we're not going to get very far with this guy. He knows his rights. He knows how the system works. I wonder if his father's a prosecutor. That's what they're really thinking, okay? So they're going to take advantage of your ignorance, and they're going to try to exploit it. Don't let them do that to you, right? Just be respectful, be polite, don't be rude to the police, but tell them, listen, I won't talk. I'm sorry, I won't talk unless I have a lawyer here. But one of the points I emphasize in the book, even people who know well enough how to assert their rights sometimes make the mistake of going in the other direction. I've said several times, don't be rude, don't be offensive and disrespectful, don't call them names. Even sure. If you think they deserve to be abused for the way they're handling you, you know it's not going to make things better if you show them disrespect. That'll never make things better. But far too many people make the mistake of going to the other extreme and say, well, maybe I better come across as uncommonly polite. And that's why the book gives numerous examples of criminal suspects who said things to the cops like this. They'd say, well, maybe I should talk to a lawyer, or do you think I should get a lawyer? Or is it possible that I can get a lawyer? And in case after case, when you talk that way to the cops, the courts later conclude, well, you know what? You didn't make an unequivocal invocation of your right to an old attorney or your right to remain silent. You were tentative. You were uncertain. Therefore, the police didn't have to stop questioning you. The Supreme Court has said the police have to get off your back and stop questioning you if and only if you are adamant and unequivocal. Now, why do people make this mistake? Why do people sound so tentative? Why do they say, well, maybe, what do you think? What do you suppose? You and I know why. They're trying to sound polite. This is the way they were raised. Too many people in our culture growing up with the idea that if I ever sound like I know what I'm talking about, if I sound like I'm informed, if I come across as sounding unequivocally and dogmatic or strident, maybe the cop will take offense. He'll think, So I'll tone it down a little bit. I'll take the edge off what I'm saying by acting like I'm not totally sure whether I want to talk to him or not. Maybe that won't sound so offensive. And they later learn it's the biggest mistake they made in their entire lives, because then the courts tell them 5 years later, sorry, you're going to go back to prison because the statement you gave to the police can be used against you. It was not inadmissible because you didn't make a proper invocation of your Fifth Amendment privilege. Just about a month ago, there was a horrible case out of Louisiana. You may have read about this, where a criminal suspect was being questioned by the police. Maybe he had read my book. I don't know if he read the last chapter. He was doing his best. He did a great job. He said to the police, look, I want to talk to you. He said, just get me a lawyer, dog. That's what he said. Get me a lawyer, dog. And the Louisiana Supreme Court, they didn't. They didn't get him a lawyer. They didn't stop questioning him. They got him to make a statement that they then wanted to use to help get him convicted. And when his lawyer said, well, you can't use that statement because he asked for a lawyer, the courts held, and the Louisiana Supreme Court essentially agreed that, well, no, you didn't make an unequivocal request because you said you wanted a lawyer dog. And they spelled D-O-G. In an opinion by a justice of the Louisiana Supreme Court, they said, the way we read the transcript, I mean, he didn't write this out. He was just talking to them. But the court said, we don't know what you mean by a lawyer dog, D-O-G. We're not sure there's such a thing. You see, that's the problem. You've got to make sure that when you talk to the police, don't be rude, but don't be polite. Please don't be polite, because it'll come back to bite you. You've got to communicate to them in short sentences. Four words is ideal. One syllable each. I want a lawyer. I want a lawyer. Don't say maybe. I'm not sure. I'm thinking. Don't. No, that's fatal to your problem. That's no way to effectively invoke your rights. You got to tell them, I need a lawyer. Say it as often as you need to. And then two wonderful things will happen. Two very good things will happen. Hopefully, if the police do it right, if they play it by the book and do what they're supposed to do, they're going to have to give up and stop interrogating you, and that's what you're trying to accomplish. If they don't stop questioning you after you told them you wanted to talk to a lawyer, and you later decide to give a statement to them because you broke down, they wore you down, you know, it can happen, by the way. One important study mentioned in the book, one study of false confessions, people who confessed to crimes we later learned they didn't commit, they found that on the average, these people were interrogated approximately 13 hours before they finally broke down. You can't blame somebody for breaking down after 13 hours of interrogation. So, and if you do break down 13 hours later, they'll be able to use that against you unless you made an unequivocal assertion of your right to an attorney. But the other good thing that'll happen if you tell the police, I don't want to talk, I need a lawyer, I want a lawyer, is that your silence also cannot be used against you as evidence of your guilt, because it's a real catch-22. The courts have said that if you don't invoke your right to remain silent and you do choose to give them information by answering a couple of questions, that can be used against you at trial. And the Supreme Court of the United States held several years ago in the case called Salinas v. Texas that if you do remain silent and exercise your right to remain silent, your silence can also be used against you as evidence of your guilt. It's damned if you do, damned if you don't. If you talk, they can use it against you. If you don't talk, they can use it against you. But luckily, that's only true if you didn't make an unequivocal assertion of your rights. So that's why that other lawyer you were talking to was exactly right. You've got to ask them two questions. Number one, first, am I free to go? You got to put them, back them into a corner. You've got to force them to say, no, you're not free to go. Because if you can get them to say, no, you're not free to go, then that means you're under arrest, and that means you are in custody. And if you are in custody, then you've got a whole another collection of rights, the rights that we've been talking about. If you're in custody and you tell them, I want a lawyer, the Supreme Court has said, then they can't use your later statements against you, and they can't use your later silence against you either. No matter which one you choose will not be admissible, but only if you're in custody. It's just like playing chess now. So you've got to get the police. You've got to get them first on the record to say, no, you're not free to go. You got to stand here. You got to stay here because we're going to detain you. We're going to put you under arrest. All right. But if you don't force them into that position by asking, and that's, by the way, why the police today will almost never tell you that you're under arrest or that you're in custody until absolutely necessary. Even if the cop has an arrest warrant in his back pocket and he's already made his mind up that he's going, that one way or another, this interview is going to end either way with you in handcuffs in the back of his car on the way downtown. First, he'll lie to you and he'll say, well, you're not a suspect. We just want to ask you a couple of questions. You're free to go, because they've learned, these police have learned through experience, and they were trained at the academy, that if they take this low-key, non-threatening approach, they're much more likely to trick you into thinking, oh, okay, good, great. He doesn't plan to arrest me. All right, then I'll talk. And then you start volunteering information that can later be used to convict you, perhaps of something you didn't do. And then when you later, and your lawyer later, tries to get the courts to throw out the confession, they'll say, well, no, it's not. It's not inadmissible. They can use it against you because you weren't under arrest. Well, he didn't read me my rights. And the court will say, he didn't have to read you your rights, your Miranda rights, because remember, he said you were free to go. He was lying to you about his intentions.
Wow.
But the point remains, he tricked you into thinking you were free to go.
Unbelievable.
When the truth was you really weren't. But because he gave you that lie and gave you that promise, and you took the bait and made the mistake of talking to him, then the statement will be admissible against you because he doesn't have to read you your rights unless you're in custody. So that's why you've got to ask them, am I free to go? If he says you're free to go, you got to wave goodbye and you got to leave. Give me your business card and say, here, if you got questions for me, send them to me and I'll get back to you as quick as I can. But leave. And if he doesn't leave, if he says, no, you're not free to go, then you say, okay, then I need a lawyer. I've got to get a lawyer. I want to have a lawyer.
Wow. You know, we watch these shows all the time. My sweetheart is addicted to another 48 hours and all of these freaking crime shows. And it's the same script every show. The police call and say, can you come down?
Yes.
And we just want to ask you a few questions about what happened to Jane Doe. And that guy or gal who goes down there never walks out of that police office. Why do we do that? Is it again because we want to help? Do we say on the phone when they call us and say, no, I want to talk to my attorney or plead the fifth? Or what do we do in that situation when it's not a police in your presence, where you're not necessarily in that moment being arrested or detained, but you're being asked to come down to help solve a particular crime? Perhaps it's a crime of somebody that you, a loved one in your family. And you talk about this in the book, and you show cases of, oh my gosh, it was a gentleman who went to work, and his wife was murdered the night before. It was his birthday. He was a little upset that she didn't, you know, do something or plan something for his birthday or whatever. And he ended up getting convicted. So what do you do in that situation when all of those emotions are in play? They call you up and say, can you come down and ask a few questions? We just want to talk to you and ask a few questions.
Yeah, I understand that. Of course I do. I mean, I'm sure that obviously there are circumstances where the advice that I'm giving is much easier said than done, especially in a situation where it's a loved one of yours who's been the victim of a terrible crime. You gave the example a moment ago that's in the book of a man in Texas who was convicted and sentenced to life in prison for a murder of his wife. He was released decades later after he found out that he was innocent.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
And he was convicted entirely on the basis of truthful information that he voluntarily gave to the police. His mistake was totally understandable. It was a natural one, because if your wife has been brutally murdered in the house when she was home alone with your son, your infant son, every fiber of your being cries out, I want to help find the guy who did this. And I want to help the police. They're the ones who claim they're the ones who are trying to find the guy. So certainly I want to cooperate with them. But that's a very, very perilous course, obviously. And the book talks about so many different ways and examples of the people who have fallen into that particular trap. You've got to be very careful, because there are unusual circumstances where the victim's family members may actually have useful information to the police that could actually help them identify the perpetrator and solve the crime and catch this guy. And in those unusual situations, it may well be worth the risk, the terrible risk, of actually getting yourself into a great deal of legal trouble if that's what it takes to bring this other individual to justice. But here's a couple of important rules and tips to keep in mind for that scenario. Rule number one, and it's difficult to do if you've recently been the victim of a terrible crime. You're not thinking clearly. Your emotions are getting the best of you. Sure. Rule number one, under no circumstances should you talk to the police without the assistance of an attorney. Okay? Have an attorney there present at the conversation to assist you in giving you advice as to which questions you should or which ones you should not answer. A lot of people on YouTube making these comments on my video and say, well, of course he advises people to ask for an attorney because he's a lawyer, he's just trying to make business for lawyers, which is absolutely not true. I'm making less work for lawyers, to tell you the truth. If all your listeners and all my readers would stop talking to the police, fewer innocent people would get arrested and charged, and there'd be a lot less need for and a lot less work for criminal defense attorneys to do. So rule number one, tell them you really want to get an attorney involved. Rule number two, make sure you get it in writing if possible. Okay. Now, that's just a general bit of advice. There will
when
be
you say in writing and getting it right. What do you mean?
Well, if they're trying to investigate a crime that has been committed 1 hour earlier, and they're still in hot pursuit, well, then that's a different situation, obviously, because then there's no time to put everything in writing. But if we're talking about a crime that was committed about a week ago, ask the police if they'll put their questions in writing for you, and then you can give them a written response. So there can be no misunderstanding or no misquotation later on down the road about whether I said we were playing cards at my house or playing cards at her house, because that's the risk you run every time you give the police truthful information. If they misrecollect just a few of the words that you used, you could be getting yourself involved or making it look like you were involved in the commission of the crime when that wasn't true at all. Another thing, by the way, as I explained in the book, another risk that you run when you agree to talk to the police or any other government agent, the courts of our country will regularly allow a police officer to testify that when he was meeting with you, you seemed suspiciously nervous, right? Because that can be used as evidence against you of your criminality or your guilt. But the courts will also allow the police officer to testify, I'm not making this up, that he seemed suspiciously calm, right? So even if you don't give them, if you sit down and talk to the police for an hour about this horrible crime that was committed against some loved one of yours, and you don't know anything about it at all, and you don't give them any information that suggests you're guilty or innocent, you may have made the terrible mistake of putting that police officer in a position where 5 months from now at the trial, when the case is starting to fall apart and he's now becoming prone to confirmation bias, he's starting to recollect things that he didn't remember at the time and he didn't put it in his report, but he'll tell the jury with a straight face, you know that Mr. Matthews, all that time we were talking, he seemed so eerily so suspiciously calm. That's how I knew that something was wrong, or that he seems suspiciously nervous. You can't eliminate that possibility as long as you talk to these people off the record in an oral conversation. That's why you want to get a videotape or put it in writing if you can. And finally, one more rule, but this probably should have been the first one. The most important rule of all, don't give the police any information unless, or answer any question unless that is information that could actually help them find the real killer. Now that's, again, a lot easier said than done when you've recently been bereaved and someone very close to you has been the victim of a horrible crime, or maybe you don't know anything about the case. But there are multiple examples, again, that I put in the book of the same sort of thing. You know, when Earl Ruffin was being interrogated by the police about this rape that we now know he didn't commit, they asked him, did you rape this woman? He said, no, I didn't. Do you know this woman? No, I do not know her, he said, which was true. And then the police said to him, they were on a roll, and they got him sort of on the rope-a-dope. They said to him, well, have you ever been near that neighborhood? Because this woman who was raped by some man who broke into her house, she lived miles away from where Earl Ruffin lived. Mm-hmm. And poor Earl, he made the horrible, tragic mistake of being honest with the cops and telling them, and this is my wording, not his, he said to them, yeah, you know, by a funny coincidence, I used to have a girlfriend who lived that same neighborhood. Now, if Earl had his wits about him at that particular moment, or if he had a lawyer there to advise him, the lawyer would have put his hands on the arm and said, Earl, don't answer that question. There's no way the answer to that question is going to help them find the real killer. It's out of the question. It's inconceivable. But, you know, Earl, he was just doing what a good, decent, civic-minded citizen would try to do at that particular moment. I'll answer all their questions because what the heck? They're the experts in law enforcement. Surely if they're asking me the question, they must think that the answer to the question is one that can help them find the real killer. And of course, the answer to the question wouldn't help do anything except maybe incriminate Earl. But he told them the truth. He said, yes, that's, like I said, I was there not long ago, even though it's miles from my house. And so poor Earl then found himself in a position where he went to trial and he had to try to persuade the jury that by the darndest coincidence they had ever heard of, he had been falsely picked out of a lineup by a woman who was raped in her house by another man, but she just happens to have picked a guy who had a girlfriend in the same neighborhood not long ago. You got to admit that's a rather implausible coincidence. And the prosecutor said that's absurd. That's no coincidence. And the jury quickly agreed. And 20 years later, DNA proved, well, guess what? It happened. It really did happen. He was telling us the truth all along. Coincidences, some of them are wildly improbable, but they actually happen. That's why we've got a word for them. Okay, so that's the problem. Don't answer questions if the answer to the question can't possibly help them find the real killer. If I can give you one more example, again, from the book. Please. A man down in Texas who was convicted of murdering his own wife. One of the key pieces of evidence against him, supposedly, at the trial, was the fact that the police asked him where he and his wife had had dinner the night before, where and when. Well, I don't fault the man. I don't criticize him for making the mistake, but he made the central mistake. He said, sure, I'll answer all your questions. Surely I want to help you do whatever I can to help you find the killer of my wife. So, foolishly, the man told the police the place and the time where he and his wife had actually had dinner the night before. Now, most people of reasonable intelligence will pause at this moment and say, well, how can that come back to haunt him? I mean, if you didn't commit the murder of your wife, if you weren't even there when somebody broke into the house and killed her in the middle of the morning, How could it be used to incriminate you that you told the police when you had dinner the night before? That's got to be a safe question, right? But if a lawyer had been there, a lawyer would have put his hand on the guy's arm and said, listen, don't answer that question. That's not going to help to find the real killer. In the book, I explain how it was that when he told the police the truth about when he and his wife had had dinner, the police gave that information to some second-rate, lousy, worthless expert. And this expert, who then testified against him at the trial, testified that based upon my examination of the contents of the stomach during the autopsy, I concluded that she was killed approximately this many hours after she had the dinner, which turns out means she was home alone with her husband, according to the information that he gave us as to when they had dinner and what time he left her in the next morning, which was all totally false, but the jury fell for it. How do they know whether this guy knows what he's talking about? That argument never would have been possible if he hadn't told the police what time the two of them had dinner. There was a case in Illinois where a young girl, I could go on like this for days, but I won't. Let me give you one more example. There was a horrible case in Illinois where a young girl was abducted from her home. The parents, naturally distraught, immediately called the police. And don't get me wrong, I probably would have done the same thing myself. They called the police and said, our daughter's been abducted. We'll do whatever it takes. We want you to help us find her as soon as possible. Not long after the investigation began, the police officers found the girl's body, and she had already been dead. She was already dead. She had been drowned. But at that point, although only a few hours had gone by, one of the officers in the investigation had for some reason become suspicious that the father might have been involved in her abduction or her murder.
Wow.
And so here's what he did. He said to himself, well, I think this guy may have been involved, which is not an unusual reaction, by the way. One friend of mine, who's a former police officer, told me that another cop he once knew said that 9 times out of 10, the one who calls in the crime is the one who committed it. 9 times out of 10, which is ridiculous. But this is what another cop actually believes. That's what you're up against sometimes when you're dealing with these individuals who think that, well, you're probably a suspect, even though because you're the one who called in the crime. So here's what happened in that Illinois case. That police officer decided that I think this guy's a suspect, and I want to find out, but I can't be straight with him. I can't tell him that he's a suspect in a murder because then I'm going to have to read him his rights and tell him about the right to an attorney, and then he may shut up and shut down. I may not be able to get any more information out of him. I want to keep him talking. So here's what they did. Believe it or not, they didn't tell the parents that the girl's body had already been found. They didn't.
Oh my gosh.
They lied to the parents and allowed the parents to continue to believe for several more hours that as far as they were aware, this was still a search and a rescue effort, that the girl might yet still be alive, but we need more information out of you. And so this guy was tricked into sitting there talking for hours about this whole thing, answering all different kinds of questions, some of which were later used to help prosecute him. And only later did he realize that he was talking all the time to police officers who were keeping him in the dark about the fact that his own daughter was already dead, that it was too late to save her, and that they thought he was a suspect. But the police will do this to you. One of the most shocking things about the book, for those who don't know a great deal about the criminal justice system, and for those who watch too much television, is that in the real world, unlike Law and Order, in the real world, police officers will lie to you all day and all night. They'll lie to you till the sun goes down, and then they'll keep lying to you after the sun goes down if they can get overtime for lying to you through the nighttime. This is what they're trained in the academy to do. This is what they are encouraged to do by the courts. It's not illegal. It's not forbidden. It's what they do all the time, and they're very good at it. They'll lie in almost any way that you can imagine, in ways that are designed to try to get you to think that it's in your interest to keep talking. They won't tell you that the victim is actually dead. They won't tell you what they're really investigating. If they're trying to trick you into admitting that you were at a high school that was burned down last night, they'll lie and say, And they'll say to you, do you mind answering a couple of questions about where you were last night? Because we're investigating a shooting that took place 100 miles away from here, out in Fresno. And you say to yourself with great relief, oh, thank God, I wasn't in Fresno. I know that I wasn't. I'm off the hook. And then, like a fool, you take the bait and you say, I was in Fresno, officer. I was down near the high school with some friends of mine. We were smoking out behind the high school. Here, check it out. Here's their names. And then you give them the names of the people that you think are alibi witnesses. Unbeknownst to you, there was no shooting in Fresno. And they're not investigating anything over there. They're trying to see if they can place you at the scene of the high school, which, like an idiot, you've just done. Now, you've placed yourself at the scene of the crime, and you've just given the names of 2 or 3 other punks who are going to be able to verify that you were there. They were supposed to be star witnesses for you. You thought they were alibi witnesses. No, it turns out now they're star witnesses to the prosecutor. And now you may have placed yourself at the scene of a fire or in some arson that was committed about a half hour after you and your friends left, which is a heck of a coincidence, but the jury will never believe that, and they'll convict you in a heartbeat under those circumstances. So you don't know what you're up against. The police don't have to put any of their cards on the table. And the cards that they do have to put on the table may be entirely misleading. They can lie to you about what they're investigating. They can lie to you about whether you're a suspect. They can lie to you about the strength of the evidence, the other evidence they have against you. Sometimes they'll say, we know you were there because we've got five other witnesses who will say that you were there. They'll say your buddy who was in the car with you, he's down the hall right now singing like a canary, and he says that you're the one who pulled the trigger. Which, by the way, may be totally false because your buddy down the hallway, maybe he's not saying another word, but they're down there lying to him about what you just said about him. This will naturally prompt both of you to start making accusations about the other. You don't know what's going on. The reality is, if you ever make the terrible mistake of agreeing to go down to the police station and let them shut that door, you've got to proceed on the assumption that you don't know anything that's going on outside that door, and that every single word you're being fed by the police about what's going on outside that door is not true, that it is false, that it is a lie, and that it is a clever lie, calculated and cleverly constructed to try to trick you into giving up your most precious constitutional rights. And by the way, if you read the book, luckily, you'll never make the mistake of going downtown, at least not voluntarily.
Absolutely.
Go down there to talk to the police.
Yeah, that's a phone call that if happened, we already know what we're going to do or what we're not going to do. So here's the rub. You know, we look at all of the things that have been happening with black police brutality, black men being killed by the police. We look at Ferguson. We look at Baltimore. We look at Chicago, the list goes on and on. And they say, well, we need to establish a relationship with the community so that there can be a level of trust. Well, based upon what I'm understanding, what I'm reading, what I'm hearing, and what I have learned, that trust is impossible.
Right.
It's almost like Santa Claus, you know, when you're a kid and you just realize, oh, Santa Claus doesn't really exist. There's no happy ending, if you will, to this story.
It's tragic, but it's true. That's exactly right. You know, the police are like Santa Claus.
It's harder then for the police to be able to do their job, because nobody's going to trust these people, and then everybody's going to shut down and invoke the Fifth, and nobody's going to say anything because you guys are trained. Well, not you guys, but I mean, you guys, yeah, are trained to say anything, do anything, lie, and make up false everything to get a conviction. So at that point, it doesn't justify me to say anything to you at all to help you regardless. So if I'm no help to you, then what's the next line of defense? This is out of control here.
It's tragic that we've got a situation in our hands where lawyers like me, and I'm not unusual, by the way, you'll get the same advice from any lawyer, any experienced criminal defense attorney, any experienced prosecutor will tell you the same thing. It's what they're telling their own kids. Remember, I told you earlier how the police don't tell their kids, listen, don't talk to the police if you're guilty. That's not what they say. They say, you just don't talk to the police. And if they call you and ask you if they'll answer a couple of questions, you say, no, you won't talk to them until I get involved. All right. Because they know the way the system has worked. They know it's a minefield. There are just way too many pitfalls, too many different ways, unexpected ways, surprising ways in which agreeing to talk to the police can turn into the biggest mistake that you regret for the rest of your life, perhaps behind bars, serving a life sentence for a crime that you didn't commit. I'm not saying that there's no situation where you should ever talk to the police. Again, I said a moment ago, if I'm a witness to a crime, if somebody close to me has been the victim of a crime, and I have good, solid, reliable evidence that could actually help the police into identifying and arresting the guy who committed this crime before he gets out of town, before he leaves the country, I'll share that information with the police. I'll take that risk in appropriate cases, if that's what has to be done to make sure that they get somebody who's committed a horrible crime, especially if it was committed against somebody very close to me. But I'm going to proceed with exceptional caution. I'm going to try to get that information in writing or on a phone call. Maybe I'll call 911 with the information. I'll give them a recording so there can't be a later disagreement 6 months from now about exactly what words I did or did not use. And there can't be some nonsensical disagreement about whether I acted suspiciously, nervous, or calm. But I won't give them any information if I don't have details that can help them find the guy who actually did this. There was a time in my life when I was a young man that I remember one night, when I was living in Cambridge, I was riding my bike through a part of Cambridge, Massachusetts, in the middle of the night, and I saw a man being viciously pummeled in the middle of the night. With my own eyes, I saw an assault, a brutal assault taking place. And I had just passed a couple of police officers who were sitting in a parking lot talking to each other just a couple of blocks back. I'm proud to say, I'm not ashamed to say, I turned around, I went right back on my bike, I told the police about it, and they came right on down, and who knows, I might have saved that guy's life. But that was different. That was unusual. That was special. I had actual information about a crime that was then in progress, where I knew there was no conceivable way that I might be falsely suspected or implicated as having been involved. They were going to get down there as soon as I gave them that information, and they were going to see the crime was in progress, being committed by a couple of people that had no connection to me. The police didn't even ask my name. They didn't even know my name, and I left. So there was no risk to me. That's an unusual situation. And there are unusual situations like that, where people have reliable information about serious crimes that have been committed, and your common sense tells you that there's no way that the police could ever possibly think that I was involved in this crime. But those cases, as I explained in the book, are much more unusual and much more unlikely than you might imagine. Now, there are plenty of people, too many people, have made the mistake of thinking, oh, they'll never think that I was involved in this. Guess what? If you're the only suspect, you're going to start to look more and more guilty the longer they look at the case. Again, the problem is police are only human. And just like all other humans, they derive powerful psychological and psychic satisfaction from the sense that, hey, I think we cracked the case. I think we found the guy who committed it. Whenever a horrible crime is committed involving murder or rape or kidnapping, obviously something deep within inside every human being cries out in the hope that, I hope we can find the guy who did this so he doesn't do it again, so there can be some justice. And the police feel the same way. And if unfortunately for you, you're the only suspect they've got because you're the one who called up and said, oh, I'm the one who found the body, or hopefully they'll find somebody else who looks like a suspect. But if not, it's only a matter of time before they're going to start looking closer and closer at you, especially if you and the victim were acquainted or family members are related. And they'll very often find a way to persuade themselves that maybe you were the one who committed the crime. Maybe you are guilty. Because, again, if you're the only suspect they've got, either they'll find a way to convince themselves that you did it, or they'll have to spend the rest of their lives with that gnawing uncertainty and that frustration of thinking, well, we were unable to close the case.
The innocent, the young, the poor, and even the elderly are extremely vulnerable.
So true. Yes, especially the innocent. Ironically, there are studies that have been done. Psychologists have found that when the police tell you, one common method of deception that is often used by the police, they'll tell you that we've got all this evidence against you. Again, there's multiple witnesses. We've got a video. We've got your fingerprints there. Maybe it's true, by the way, but most of the time it isn't true. They're trying to bluff, that's all. They're trying to bluff you into thinking, oh my God, look at all this evidence they've got against me. I guess I better admit that I was. Terrible crime, thereby admitting that you might have been able to have committed the crime when otherwise they couldn't have even put you at the scene. It turns out that innocent people are especially likely to fall prey to this kind of deception, as surprising as that may sound, because after 5, 6, 10 hours of this kind of unrelenting interrogation, innocent people frequently, they just fold and they say, you know what? I've been sitting here for 10 hours telling them I didn't do it, that I wasn't there. I don't know anything about it. They keep saying they don't believe me. I guess the only way to bring this interview to an end is just to tell them what they want to hear. I'll say that I was there. I say that I did it. And then I'll go get a great lawyer, like that guy I saw on YouTube, because some fast-talking lawyer, he'll be able to Lee Matthews show. He'll be able to get me off, right? Because, and here's the rub. They think, because I know I'm innocent, surely the justice system, justice will prevail. That's how it works. The innocent are acquitted. Well, yeah, sometimes, but no, not always. And there's not much some fast-talking, brilliant lawyer even can do for you after you've already told the police that you actually committed the crime. So,
the other thing is that I'm thinking of parents who might get questioned by the police, and as a result, they'll end up harming their child even more.
Right.
I mean, you think I'm going to protect my baby. I'm going to protect my child. I'm going to do whatever whatever they ask me. So as a mother or as a father, you're going down there and they're actually using everything that you say against your child.
Right.
It's absolutely insane. Absolutely insane.
No, that's true. That's true. You know, and when the police pick up your kid, your child of any age, very often, when the parents find out, if they find out what's going on, they'll notify the police. They'll contact the police, and they'll say, I understand you're interrogating my teenage son down there. Can I talk to him? And the surprising truth is that the police have every right to say, well, actually, no. We're not going to let you talk to him, which is not true. It's another lie. They could if they wanted to do this, But they'll say to the parents, well, your son's in there and he's agreed to talk to us. He's voluntarily waived his right to remain silent. He's voluntarily waived his right to an attorney. And he's been in there for 4 hours, and we don't want to end the interrogation. We don't want to end the interview. And the mom says, well, let me talk to him for a minute, okay? The police, if they're nice, they might say, sure, we'll allow it. But if they think this kid is talking himself into admitting that he committed a crime, they're not obligated to interrupt. They're not obligated to tell the kid, hey, your mom's outside. Your dad, your Uncle Philippe is outside, and they've got a lawyer they've hired, and they want you to meet with a lawyer. As incredible as it may sound, wow, under the law, the police don't have to stop that interview until the young man on the other side of the door says, I want a lawyer. Even though the parents are out there with a lawyer who's already been paid, the police are entitled to keep questioning the kid as long as the kid keeps saying, I'm willing to talk. I don't need a lawyer. I'm willing to talk. He's the one who can make the decision for himself. And in the meantime, he may be admitting things that will be later used to help convict him of a crime that he didn't commit. So that's why it's vital. You know, we joke and we try to make this kind of lighthearted, but it really is vital that people pick up this book or something like this book, and they get this information into the hands of all of their young loved ones before it's too late, because once they've been picked up by the police, it's too late. The police won't give you the opportunity to call a quick little timeout, a little halftime huddle. Can I meet with him for a couple of minutes and talk to him about what he ought to do next? They can do that if they want, but generally the police won't give you that opportunity. You got to give them that information before the day they get picked up and the day they get rounded up, after they've been falsely implicated maybe in something they didn't do.
Ladies and gentlemen, you guys know me very well. You know the integrity of the show that I do, and you know what it takes for me to get some of these brilliant minds that I have had access to that for some reason do come on and talk to me, of which I'm so honored and blessed to have. And this is one of them, and this is in my opinion, of being able to deal with the assault of poor, uneducated minority people in America, whether you're, and even though it's not about color, in my situation, it's always about color. This is probably one of the most important books that you must have in your, it's great to know about your Black history. It's great to know about, you know, the Constitution and the wall. All of that stuff is great, but none of that is going to save your life and your freedom if you don't know your rights. And so this is the only book that I know of that I have read thus far. I'm sure there's others, but I, you know how I am. I go out, I read the book, and then I find the expert who wrote the book and say, maybe I can get that expert on the show to talk about the book, which we've done. And it took, you were out of the country when I had first reached out to you, Professor Duane. But you have the right to remain innocent is a must have. It's the end of the year. You want to start this year out right. Start your year out with information that will save your life, save the life of your loved ones. I just admire you for your work and what you've done. You didn't have to do it, but we're glad that you did it. Okay. And I think the work that you're doing now is more needed and more necessary than ever before. Close us out with your thoughts for the upcoming year and what you know, what do you want to get out of, I know you want to make millions and millions of books to the Duane, to the Professor Duane, James Duane Fund. I remember that YouTube video. So there's some links down there, ladies and gentlemen, to some previous YouTube videos. This guy is the most engaging lecturer ever. He's absolutely hilarious. Tell us the story about Loretta Lynch.
Loretta Lynch, she was the Attorney General, the Attorney General under President Obama, and she was a classmate of mine in college and in law school, as a matter of fact. So she was a friend of mine. I had the privilege, had the pleasure of running into her a few years ago at a college reunion, where she was nice enough to, after I finally worked my way through the security detail to get close enough to let me take a picture of her. It's one of those videos that you've got linked there for your viewers to watch.
Absolutely amazing. Thank you, my friend. I really appreciate you.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you, too, for the work that you do, which is just as important and no less significant in getting the word out, enabling your viewers to understand the most fundamental and most precious constitutional rights. I'm looking forward, you know, I'm looking forward, if enough people can get the word, get the message, and understand what it is that the police are telling their own kids. I'm hoping that eventually we may come to see a transformation of the criminal justice system. When the police and the courts come to realize, come to reckon with the implications of what they've done for far too long, police academies and courts have given the police training and skills and encouragement in all kinds of methods of grotesque deception to trick both the guilty and the innocent alike into admitting things that can be used to help convict them. That's why we've got a situation tragically on our hands right now where every knowledgeable observer has to advise their loved ones, no, you don't take that bait. You don't take that risk. You can't run that risk. Mm-hmm. Can't talk to these people. If enough people get that message, gradually law enforcement is going to shut down to such a drastic extent that we may actually live, or maybe the next generation may live to see a day when the police and the courts come to realize, you know, the old system that we had where we allowed the police to lie about everything, after word finally eventually got out through that, because of that Matthews guy and that Duane guy, after the word got out to everybody that this was the way the system worked, everybody dried up, everybody clammed up. Now nobody talks to the police. We're getting less information now than ever before because people eventually wised up to the way we were exploiting deception and exploiting their good faith and exploiting the good intentions and their ignorance. And then maybe we'll live, or maybe the next generation will live to see a day when the courts will change the rules altogether and say to the police, no, you've got to be straight with people. You've got to be honest with them. You've got to tell them the truth, just the same way you expect them to be truthful with you. Trust is a two-way street. You can't expect these people to be trusting and trustworthy when the reality is that you're lying to them all day, every day about everything they need to know about how to make this very important decision. And don't forget, if I might add, we've been talking a lot about how it is that our legal system gives the police all kinds of encouragement and all kinds of latitude to lie to you about everything. But don't you make the mistake of thinking it is okay if you lie to them, because that's not true. That's a federal offense. You can go to prison for 5 years for telling a lie to the police. Imagine that. Try to wrap your head around that. This crazy idea, this obscene double standard that says they can lie to you all day long about everything in every aspect of the case, overstate the evidence against you, understate the evidence against you, tell you you're not a suspect, we're not going to prosecute you, we're going to give you immunity. You can see easily how promises like that could easily trick even an innocent person into thinking, well, I got nothing to lose. He says I'm not a suspect. He says I'm going to be on their side. They're going to use me as a witness against the other young men. It turns out that was a lie, and the courts let him get away with it left and right. And yet, if heaven help you, if the police decide several months later, you know, the way we recall the conversation, we think he gave us some information that wasn't true. He said that he was down there at the high school, but we've got a couple of witnesses who say that he was somewhere else. It turns out the witnesses actually are mistaken, because eyewitnesses make mistakes. But now all of a sudden, because of your good intentions and your willingness to try to help the police out, you've just given them the linchpin, the missing piece of the puzzle. And now you can be prosecuted and put behind bars for the separate criminal offense of lying to the cops about where you were that night. Because it's your word against this other young woman who maybe knew you back when the two of you were in high school together. She's got no reason to lie, no motive to lie. She's really quite sure that you were with her on the other side of town when you told the police you were somewhere else. Truth is, she's just mistaken, because she's only human. Eyewitnesses make mistakes. But if that case goes to trial, the jury's going to convict you in a heartbeat, because they'll say, well, why should we doubt her? She seems so sure. She says she's 100% certain, and she will be, by the way, by the time the police are done working with her behind closed doors. And you're saying, no, she's mistaken. She's lying here. I don't know. She's confused. You're the one who's on trial. You're the one with the motive to lie. That's why they're going to find her more believable. And now here you are in a situation where you could be convicted and put behind bars for lying to the police, where there would have been no such risk at all if you had said nothing to them at all.
Unbelievable. And the sad part is this, that, you know, some of them have gotten lucky by getting out 20 some odd years later, but your life has been pretty much lost. And then there's so many that are just, we'll never know.
Oh, that's right.
Never know. They're gone.
Oh, that's true. That is so true. You know, when we look at the fact that the Innocence Project has now secured the release of over 300 innocent men and women, many of whom were serving life sentences, some of them were on death row for crimes that we now know they did not commit. You know, some people, far too many people, are ridiculously naive. They look at these numbers and they say, oh, well, hopefully that's everybody. Hopefully that's all the innocent folks. We found them all, and then our system eventually finds a way to exonerate the innocent. That is preposterously naive. You'd have to be wildly ignorant or willfully ignorant to honestly believe that this isn't just the tip of the iceberg, because these hundreds of people who are able to secure and approve their innocence sufficiently to obtain an exoneration, almost all of them were accused of sex offenses or rape or some other kind of a crime where the perpetrator left behind some sort of a biological sample that could be subjected to DNA testing, right? Maybe some skin or some semen or some hair, or that's how we're able to prove that we definitely got the wrong guy.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is the very large majority, the vast majority of all people serving life sentence in state and federal prisons around the country are not in there for some sort of a sex offense. They're in there because they committed some other crime, maybe even more serious or just as serious, maybe something like murder, where there was no biological evidence that was left behind that could be subjected to DNA testing. For those poor people, no matter how innocent they may be, the prospects that they'll ever be successfully exonerated are pretty close to zero. But the reality is, if you've got one guy who's convicted or accused of rape and another guy accused of murder, neither one is inherently or intrinsically more likely than the other to be the victim of mistaken identification by an eyewitness who just didn't get a good look. That could happen to either one of them. Neither mm-hmm. one of them is more likely to be the victim of some mm-hmm. sort of a rat fink cellmate who's lying through his teeth about a confession you supposedly made to him because he's trying to cut a deal with the prosecutor to get some time shaved off his sentence. That can happen just as likely in the rape case as in the murder case. So you've got to be ridiculously naive and ignorant to honestly believe that all these hundreds of people that we've been able to get out of prison through the DNA evidence, that's pretty much everybody. That's got to be false. There's no way that isn't the tip of the iceberg. God only knows how many thousands of innocent men and women are behind bars today for crimes they didn't commit. But we'll never know. Not in this life.
We'll never know. And it's happening right now as we're speaking.
Sure, sure. That's why I'm a criminal defense attorney. I used to do it full time. Now I just do it part time. And like every other criminal defense attorney, I work round the clock trying to do my best to try to see what I can do to get people out of prison after they've been falsely convicted, or to try to fix the situation halfway through the trial to see what we can do to make the best of some difficult situation. But at that point, once it gets to that point, it can be very difficult to get the guy off or to get an acquittal, even if he's innocent. That's why I'm doing whatever I can to try to get the word out so the people, innocent people, will understand. If you talk to the police or talk to any other agent who works for the government, you're playing with fire. You're rolling the dice and taking the worst, you may well be taking the worst gamble you've ever taken in your life. There's just so many ways that could end up coming back to haunt you as the biggest mistake of your entire life, and you'll spend the rest of your life regretting it.
Absolutely. And the last thing is that you know, as you said, we're talking about men and women, but unfortunately, one of the things that happens, that is happening right now, is so many of our kids, our youth, are being sent away forever and tried as adults because they're kids. They don't, they're terrified. Can you imagine what that's like to have your, you know, to know that you're never going to see mommy and daddy again, and you walk in there, it's almost a heinous crime. It's just absolutely heinous.
Oh yeah, yeah. There was a horrible case in California a few years ago of a teenager who was picked up by the police and asked about a shooting, and the kid insisted that he wasn't involved, that he didn't have anything to do with it, and he didn't commit the crime. And then he didn't want to talk to them. This young man had the presence of mind to tell the police, I don't think I want to answer your questions. He tried to make an equivocal assertion of his right to remain silent, but it wasn't unequivocal. So the police kept on persisting. They kept on interrogating him. And finally, they broke this kid down, and they deceived him. They tricked him into giving up his right to remain silent because they promised him. They said, look, even if you go to prison for this, even if you were involved, your worst case scenario is you're not going to be in prison until you're 25 years old. And the kid was 16. So the cops promised him to his face on the record, it was recorded, that even if he was convicted, he wouldn't go to prison for more than 9 years. Well, you can understand how a frightened, anxious, scared kid in the middle of the night might well think, oh my God, 9 years in prison, that's a terrible thing. But if that's the worst thing that can happen to me, maybe I better admit that I was there. And so he did. He denied that he was involved in the crime, but he said, you know, I was there. He said, I was high. I was taking some drugs and I was high, but I was in a car with somebody else who I think may have been the trigger man who may have shot the kid. Well, he thought this wouldn't get him a great deal of trouble, but based upon that information, simply placing himself at the scene of the crime, the prosecutor was able to use that evidence along with certain other circumstantial evidence to persuade the jury to convict this kid of having been involved in the shooting, and he was sentenced to 45 years to life in a California prison. In a California prison. And his attorney argued, as you would expect, that, wait a minute, you can't use that statement. Again, remember, this kid, he never confessed. He didn't say that he committed the crime. He just admitted that he was there. And that was the linchpin that they needed to put together a very shaky case, which was entirely circumstantial. And the only way they got the kid to admit that he was there was by lying to him and promising him, you won't go to jail past age 25. And his lawyer said to the California Court of Appeals, wait a minute, you can't let the police get away with this. They told the kid, they told the young man he'd be out 9 years at worst. And he got 45 years. Surely you can't allow that in a civilized nation that calls itself the land of the free and the home of the brave, that pledges eternal vigilance, the pursuit of justice and truth. And the California Court of Appeals said, actually, we don't have a problem with that. And the kid's sentence was affirmed on appeal. And the police were able to use that statement against him, even though they got it out of him by promising him, you're not going to go to jail for more than 9 years. So you need, like I said before, no offense. I mean, no disrespect to the police. These are the realities. You can look this up. I'm telling you, everything I'm telling you and your listeners, they can see for themselves if they had the lifetime to spend at the law library, as I've spent, looking sure. through these books.
Do you get any pushback or on this at all? I mean, from the police? I mean, because it seems contraindicated. I mean, you know.
Well, that's why I'm broadcasting this from a remote, undisclosed location in Belgium right now.
Got it. No. Okay. Yeah, we can't tell anybody where he's at, ladies and gentlemen. That's true. That's true.
I am not. But no, actually none at all. I've spoken to a great number of lawyers, of cops, police officers, about that video. I run into them on the streets, or they're dating or married to one of my former students or something like this. And they all tell me the same thing. They smile and they say, I saw your video. I like the video. Nice video. And I say, well, do you disagree with it? And they all say the same thing. No, it's all true. It's all true. I've heard from multiple sources that numerous police officers are now showing that famous video at the police academy. I don't know why exactly. I guess they're showing the future police officers what they're up against because of the information I'm giving to their future suspects.
Well, let's talk. I mean, I know you got to go, my gosh, because every time I try to let you go, it's like there's another layer here. So it is getting harder to plead the fifth and to invoke the fifth. If they're showing this at the police academy, of course, they're trying to figure out how to crack this thing because you are a threat to their prosecutions and subsequently to their jobs and what have you. So what are we up against? What's new? What's going on? What is there any new laws or legislations that's coming down that or any new tactics that we need to be aware of?
No, there's nothing new under the sun.
There's a pause there, Professor. Something's going on with the pause.
With the what?
You pause there for a moment. There's always something going on with the pause.
Well, I mean, the latest development is one that I mentioned earlier. In 2013, in the Salinas case, the Supreme Court came down with this absolutely wretched decision where they announced that if you're not in custody and you don't tell the police you want to remain silent, but you just clam up and become silent. In other words, you exercise your right to remain silent without asserting your right to remain silent, then, believe it or not, your silence can be used against you at trial as evidence of your guilt. That was a shocking ruling by the Supreme Court, and it was wrong, it was indefensible, it was unquestionably mistaken, but that's now the rule. That's not the law. That's now the law. So that was not
true. So there's a difference between exercising and what was the other word?
Between exercising the right to remain silent, which you can do just by keeping your mouth shut, or asserting or invoking your right to remain silent. In that case, the five Republican appointees on the U.S. Supreme Court, the court split 5-4. The four Democratic appointees all voted to give this kid another trial. But the four Republican appointees to the Supreme Court all unanimously agreed that if a young man tells the police, well, he just simply clams up and doesn't answer one of their questions, and he doesn't tell them why he's not answering the question, we don't know why he refused to answer. We don't know whether he was actually exercising his right to remain silent. Therefore, the Supreme Court said it's okay to use that silence against him as evidence of his guilt. Unbelievable.
Wow.
That's why... Again, forgive me for repeating, but it bears repetition. That's why now it's more important than ever before that you ask the police, is it okay if I go? Am I free to go? You got to put them on the spot. You got to force them to say, well, actually, no, you're not free to go. We're going to detain you by force. Because now you're in custody. And if you're in custody, the Supreme Court has said, then your exercise of your right to remain silent cannot be used as evidence against you. It shouldn't make any difference at all, but unfortunately, it does make a difference. That's why you got to put these people on the spot. That's why you know, in the courtroom, we have something called leading questions, right? Where you're putting words in the mouth of the witness. And normally they're forbidden in the courtroom, except on cross-examination. But now we've got a situation, as strange as it may sound, probably for the first time in American history, where people like you and like me have to advise young people to start using leading questions on the police. You know, tell the police, am I free to go? I'm free to go, right? I have the right to remain silent, don't I? and force them to say, yes, you've got the right to remain silent. Yes, you've got the right to a lawyer. Yes, you're in custody. I'm not free to go, right? Am I being detained? And if you can push them to a position where they admit what's really going on and what you're up against, it's going to be better for you in the long run in every way.
Wow. Thank you.
It shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be the case that frightened, young, anxious, uneducated, poorly educated 16-year-olds have to put the police officer on the spot to extract the truth from him, like pulling teeth. But that's the reality, because the police are not obligated to tell you the truth about anything, certainly not what you're up against, unless you force them to give it to you. And even then, there's no guarantee that what they'll tell you is true.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to send this video to every high school that you know, your kids. This is something, you know, let's have a meeting in your house, you know, just sit down and watch this video, watch this show tonight. Make it a part of your program in your life, because this is what's going to save our communities and subsequently help us get out of the situation that we're in, because it's not going to get better if we don't get knowledge and information. And it's not about just getting the knowledge and information. It's then invoking that knowledge and information, activating that knowledge and information. And I know that we, you know, so this is why we do the show. Sometimes we don't like to read or feel like, oh, you know, okay, that's great. Well, the great thing about Amazon is that you can get this in audio, and so you can listen to it if you don't want to read it or you don't have time, and you could do it while you're shopping or doing whatever it is that you're doing. But it's just necessary and mandatory that you absorb this information and make it a part of your daily life, just like getting up and you know, brushing your teeth and washing behind your ears. Stick around with me in the green room, Professor, as we sign off. There's a six-second delay. We'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthew Show. Again, subscribe, like, share, comment, but most importantly, share. Probably one of the most important shows that I have done in my 25 years of doing this work. So I so appreciate you, Professor James Duane. You are absolutely amazing. Thank you.
The respect is mutual.